Well, good evening, and thank you for joining us tonight for this edition of what we call here Ask Pastor John. It's our live studio broadcast where typically we have John Piper in here and we take a couple hours and we ask John a lot of questions about all kinds of different things, and you all provide those questions. Tonight it's a really special broadcast because we have with us tonight Paul Tripp. So as we've promoted this and encouraged folks to tune in, we've called this Ask Paul Tripp Night, and we're thankful that you're here and you get to be a part of this. We've done about 9 of these broadcasts in the past, and we hope to do more of these in the future, assuming that tonight goes well and that there's folks actually out there on the other side of this camera that are tweeting in questions. And we encourage you to do that. You're welcome to just jump onto Twitter and tweet in any question that you'd like to on really any range of topic that you think Paul might be interested in or interested in answering. And then how that works is that our team here is collecting those as the broadcast is going on live. And they're culling from those some of the best or most unique questions, and they're sending those over to me here. And then, Paul, I will turn and ask those to you, and hopefully it'll be a great night. We'll take a couple of breaks throughout the evening. I'll announce those for the broadcast, and that's for your sake as well as for our sake. So maybe about 40 minutes into the broadcast tonight, and then again later in the evening, we'll take another short break. But feel free just to stay there if you're able to, if you need to come or go. We're just thankful that you felt that you wanted to be a part of this tonight. So we hope it's profitable for you and for your soul, and we trust that God will work and bless us during our time together. I want to give a brief introduction to Paul. Many of you know Paul from his books, and there's about 11 books that Paul has written now, including this latest book from Crossway Books, and it's entitled, What Did You Expect? Redeeming the Realities of Marriage. And in this book, Paul goes through and really takes the gospel and applies it over and over to a lot of the practicalities of married life. But Paul has done more than that. He's the president of Paul Tripp Ministries, but he's also a pastor at 10th Presbyterian Church in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Paul also serves as the executive director for the Center for Pastoral Life and Care in Dallas. And he's married to Luella, and they have been married 38 years, and they have 4 grown children. Paul's great passion, his great desire in ministry is to connect the transforming power of Jesus Christ to everyday life. And he's tried to do this throughout all of his ministry, in his teaching and in his preaching, in his counseling and in his writing. And we trust tonight as we do this Ask Paul Tripp 2-hour broadcast, we trust that that will happen for us here and for you out there as well. So I'm just going to take a moment and open our time with a word of prayer, and then we'll get right down to the questions. So please join me in praying. Father, we do ask now that you would come and send your Holy Spirit and bless this broadcast. We ask that you would empower our minds and give us clear questions and helpful questions. And I pray that you would bless with helpful answers, that you would cause us to have a desire for you and a means of loving you better through understanding how you work in this world and how you intend to work in our lives through the gospel. So get glory for your name. And we ask this in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Well, let's get down to some of the questions here. And you know, the first question that I'd like to lead with tonight is one that has come up from several of you, have tweeted this in. I think it's an important topic. I think it's something that we need to, probably get this out of the way right from the beginning. And this question's come in various ways and various shapes and forms. But Paul, it has to do with the stash, with the mustache. You know, how long you've been growing it? When's the last time you shaved it or trimmed it? How does your wife like it? How do your kids appreciate it? You know, is it something that you've trademarked? What's up with the mustache?
Well, I have to take the cover off the mustache. It's not actually a mustache. It's a mutation. I have 3 of them on my back. My mom had one right here. You used to say, Mom, shave, we're going out to eat.
That's great.
So that's the story of the mustache.
Okay, it
is. Just
excellent.
A family mutation.
It does tend to run in the family.
Yeah, it does.
Noticed.
It does.
Okay. All right. Very, very good. Well, more seriously, let's jump to, let's talk a little bit about your life. Just give us a kind of a 50,000-foot flyover now of how did you come to know the Lord? And how did you sense a call into ministry generally? And then how did you sense a call into the more specific ministry that you've been doing over the past 10 or 15 years?
I was raised in a Christian family. I'm very, very thankful that every morning my dad would get us up in the morning and read scripture to us. He wasn't a teacher. In fact, I don't actually know if my father was a believer, but he would start in Genesis and read to Revelation and start again. And that, I think the legacy for me was a fear of God, a God awareness, a sense that the world was really about God and God's will. Although, alongside of that, I would say that my family was very troubled. There were things that went on in the interior of the family life that were contradictory of the gospel of grace that I was hearing elsewhere. And I think that really birthed this desire inside of me to see these grand biblical themes connected to the interior of one's life. And as I got into college, there was a desire to go into journalism. But my mom encouraged me to study scripture first. And the more I did, the more questions I had, the more that zeal that was early born inside of me to connect life and truth was born. I came to Christ at 8 years old. I was spending the whole summer at a camp as an eight-year-old. I think my parents emptied the house because there was some trouble there. And I'm very, very thankful for a camp counselor who presumed to teach through Romans with eight-year-old boys. And by the time I got to Romans 3, I was, by God's grace, powerfully aware of my sin. I was on the third bunk as a little boy, and in the middle of the night, I couldn't sleep. I was under such conviction. And so I climbed down because I thought that I should kneel, and knelt in the middle of the camp floor and pleaded for God's forgiveness and his acceptance of me into his family. Is a very, very clear, conscious moment of seeking God's help and confessing sin. And as I went through seminary, there was still this percolating inside of me that we need to do better as a church in those hardline connections of belief to life. I don't think that faith is just something you do with your brain. Faith is what you do with your life. That what you do with your brain is a preparation for what you do with your life. By God's plan, I ended up as a pastor, founding pastor of a small church in Scranton, Pennsylvania. I always say that Scranton was a place where the American dream died in 1950. And old coal and railroad country, it was troubled people, and I was doing much more and more counseling. Ended up going to Westminster Seminary just to study biblical counseling and again to enhance that connection between belief and life that has really become the passion and zeal of my ministry.
Let's talk a little bit about your kind of your writing ministry. Maybe just walk us through how some of those early books developed and why they developed. And then did you ever feel a sense of call to writing as a form of ministry, a channel of ministry? Did it flow out of the preaching and teaching? Just talk to us about Paul Tripp as a writer.
I think that the call that I felt was to be a good steward of the gifts that God had given me, and an obvious way of doing that was writing. I don't know if today I still think of myself as a writer. I think of myself as a speaker who writes, although I've learned the craft. And I was doing a lot of counseling of teenagers. I was very sobered by the fact that parents thought that this was a negative period of time and they had a survival mentality that led to my first book, Age of Opportunity. And as I worked on that material, people around me began to say, you ought to put this in print. And I wanted to start writing not ministry books so much, but as everyday life books, that that people would see that the gospel is the world's best diagnostic. And because it's the world's best diagnostic, it is going to offer the world's best cure, because effective cure is always the result of accurate diagnosis. And I thought if I could place Jesus in the middle of the mess, whether that's parenting or communication or midlife or whatever, I would be used of God to help people to love Jesus more and to have greater confidence in the Word of God. I mean, that's really what I'm after in ministry, not just to solve human problems, but to enhance people's desire to find satisfaction in the glory of Christ and to live for the glory of Christ and to live out of an identity in Christ that's life-shaping. Maybe that means I've only ever written one book. I just keep saying it's the gospel, and here's how the gospel speaks to this particular dimension. I don't have anything to offer but the gospel. I mean, I don't have any wisdom of my own. I often think, what would I ever tell people if it weren't for this beautiful story of the personal work of Jesus?
Amen. Very helpful. We had someone tweet in this question, Paul, have there been certain books or authors that have influenced you, either in the extent of your ministry or maybe as you've moved in your own writing, folks that you found to be helpful or influential?
I could answer that in a very specific way. My ministry was dynamically shaped by the Puritans. The zeal of the Puritans for not just understanding theology, but for godliness. I remember reading a section of John Owen's in the Mortification of the Flesh where he made some point and then there were like 14 pages of application. And I read that and I thought, this is what we're meant to do with the Word of God. It has to live in the hallways and kitchens and bathrooms and bedrooms and vans of everyday life. It must live there, and that became my passion.
Excellent. Wonderful. Yeah. All right. Well, let's jump to a couple of, and just for our viewers' sake, we are going to kind of jump around. We'll have some questions that deal, that are more biographical and story-oriented from Paul's life. But we'll also jump to some questions that are, you know, much more specific. Some are a little heavier, some are a little bit lighter. And let's just talk back. You mentioned writing the book Age of Opportunity. And that book, it's a powerful, helpful book that I'm sure many of our viewers are familiar with. We've got a question here that comes in, and they want to talk a little bit about your own personal experience, but also for their sake. How do you counsel somebody who's dealing with an unbelieving parent or two unbelieving parents? Or can what you're teaching in Age of Opportunity and things like that really happen in what is becoming a more dysfunctional home situation, especially in this country? Single parent, broken homes, unsaved parent, that type of thing. So just speak to the whole parenting, gospel parenting piece with respect to dysfunctionality in the home.
You know, one of the ways I think about that is that we are living in a fallen world. I think that we can tend to take the theology of fall not as seriously as it's presented in Scripture. This world is a broken place.
Okay.
It doesn't operate the way God intended. We're living amongst flawed people. Now that means that there are always situational and relational limits on me. I don't live in a perfect world. Things don't happen perfectly. There are huge disappointments, there are shocking changes in my life, a phone call can alter your world. But the gospel speaks into that world. I think it's important to understand that Jesus didn't just die for my past or die for my future, He died for my here and now. The gospel speaks into the harshest, most difficult realities of the here and now. 2 Peter says that Jesus has already given us everything we need for life and godliness. Why does Peter use two words? Well, I think because he knows his audience, that if he said Jesus had given us everything we need for life, we would think, well, yeah, sure, eternal life, isn't that wonderful? He used a second word, godliness. What is godliness? It's God-honoring desires, choices, responses, actions, words in the particular place where God in His sovereignty has placed me. So the godliness that Christ makes possible and that God calls me to is not obstructed by reality. It's given for reality. And so you wouldn't want to think, as a single mom, for example, that this makes the call of God impossible. Because the fallen world doesn't do that. The gospel is for people living in the fallen world. Now, is that a particular difficulty? Sure it is. Is it hard to do the thing that two people were designed to do as one person? Yes, it is. But to think that this puts me in a different paradigm is not good thinking. This is the exact brokenness paradigm that the gospel speaks to. It speaks to broken world. That's what it's for. It's for broken people in a broken world. And that's why the ultimate promise of the gospel is I'm going to make everything new. Because it recognizes that Jesus meets me, restores me, enables me, empowers me, motivates me, encourages me, loves me, forgives me, gets me up in the morning again in the fallen world, but He's going to take me out of it. And that's my hope.
Okay. So to that mom or that dad, you would say the main goal then on Monday morning when you get out of bed is not to focus on being a better parent, but to focus on resting in the gospel.
Sure, and to remember your identity, that you're not seeking meaning and purpose, you're not seeking peace, you're not seeking strength, you've already been given all of those things. I'm not after things that I don't have. I'm living out of what I've been given. Here's the way I like to think of it. When you're looking at change, the way the gospel thinks about change is this is who you are becomes before this is what you should do. I've got to remind myself of what I've been given. And so I do what I'm doing, not because of what my child is doing, not because of my trust in my child, but because of my trust in Christ.
Mm. Okay, helpful. Now, you would acknowledge that there is a doing to parenting.
Oh, absolutely.
There's techniques and there's things. Talk a little bit about that to parents who want to strike that balance between resting themselves in the gospel and yet doing out of that resting various things to help with their parenting.
Yeah, I think there's a couple things I would say that a child needs firm, loving discipline, authority, and grace. I need to be committed to that regular guidance. We live in a world of authority. I need to image the authority of the Lord, and I need to be a person of grace. The reason why grace is an important word there is there is a tendency for parents in their appropriate concern for their children to ask the law to do what only grace can accomplish. If a parent, by the enforcement of the law, by the tone of your voice, by the force of your personality, if you could change the heart of your child, Jesus would have never had to come. And so what I have to realize is my job is to act appropriately toward my child so they would desire to transact with God. But I can't do that transaction. And I don't know when the winds of the Spirit will blow. So I understand that I'm freed from saying change is my responsibility. Godliness is my responsibility. I am a tool in the hands of a Redeemer. I say to parents this way, you can have the best wood, the best nails, the best tools, and you can put them in an empty field, and they're never going to build a house. A carpenter builds a house. We are his wood. We're his nails. We're his hammers. But he's the one that creates the change. I think that's liberating. It's just not my job. And so I get up, I believe in God's truth, I believe in the power of grace, I believe in the truths of the gospel, I believe in the wisdom of Scripture, I believe in His call to love like I've been loved, and I'm going to keep doing that every day. Not based on my track record, how well I've been doing, not based on the size of the problem, but based on the glory of Christ and His gospel.
Do you find, and feel free to speak from your kind of your counseling experience here, do you find when parents are pursuing that, is to the best of their understanding and ability, kind of a gospel approach to parenting, where they're really trying to live out of the promises of God's Word for them as parents in Christ, do you find that it's fairly normative, that's the right word to use, is it somewhat normative for God to then honor that and bless that, and thus the children, as we say in our culture, quote-unquote, turn out okay? You know, there's a perpetuating kind of a generational faithfulness thing happening. If that ought to be normative for the Christian home, or really, if you've got four kids at home, you know, you're not accountable for the change. You pray hard, you trust God, you live out of the gospel, but at the end of the day, two of the four of them walk away from the Lord, or they don't have the same passions as the others. What have you seen from your experience?
I think normative or regular is a good word. I don't think you want to make it mechanical.
A guarantee.
It's a guarantee or a factory. But grace is a gorgeous thing. It's a gorgeous thing to watch grace operate. Love, I mean, you think of the love of Christ. It's the most powerful force of transformation in the universe. You know, for a parent to sit next to a struggling kid and say, you know, I really do love you. And when I talk with you, it's not like a judge and a jury to get you in trouble, but I really believe that there's life available to you that you're not getting, and I'm like you, I get it. I love my idols. I hate authority. You live with me. You see my struggle. I mean, that kind of talk is just compelling. I mean, it's hard to walk away from that self-disclosing, gracious encounter and say, my dad's a monster. And so I think there is a way that God blesses that, breaks down the defensiveness of children. It gets harder and harder to hate that person because there's something beautiful about the way that human being is living that you think, I would like that. I've seen that in counseling. I've watched teenagers who just, they want everything within them, they want to hate me because I'm sort of the hired hand of their parents.
Right.
But six sessions down, they can't hate me because I'm not hate-worthy. And they begin to sort of let down the defenses. They almost are angry that they're doing it. And before long, we have just a wholesome friendship. It's the gospel. It's the power of the gospel.
Excellent.
I mean, I wouldn't be smart enough to manipulate a person into that. I'd get angry and push them away. But the call of the gospel just is that patience and perseverance of grace that is so infectious.
Okay, let's go with that for a second. Let's talk about this idea of grace being a beautiful, gorgeous, powerful thing. Grace on the move in the light in the lives of our children. This was a great question that came in from email or from Twitter earlier in the week. How do you know if you have your child's heart? Or maybe it's easier if you don't have your child's heart. If you've lost your child's heart because you've been hate-worthy or because you haven't been parenting out of this wellspring of gospel life, how do you get that heart back? What's that look like?
Well, I think a couple of things. I think if you are aware that this relationship has been stained by anger, condemnation, impatience, the actions and words that don't depict grace, you got to go and confess that to the child. And you have to ask for forgiveness. You have to talk about the fact that you know you've been forgiven by Jesus, but you really want that horizontal transaction to take place. You need to commit yourself in front of that child to a new way of living. Need even to welcome that child to come to you and say, if you think I'm not living that way, there's a respectful way of you saying that to me, because I want to be an instrument of grace in your life. And then You have to understand the call. If I could define love, I'd define love this way. Love is willing self-sacrifice for the good of another that doesn't require reciprocation or that the person being loved is deserving. I mean, that's a cruciform, a cross-shaped definition of love. Christ was willing. He knew sacrifice was in front of him. He died for people who were his enemies. And he knew they wouldn't be deserving. And so I have to realize, as I'm loving this teenager, love does its best work. Grace is its richest when the person isn't deserving. Instead of love getting weak and saying, oh, it's not worth it, that's when love rises. Because the only thing that can break that down and build that bridge is love. I mean, what happens when a parent waits to be loving for the teenager to get his act together? You just get this horrible standoff. Rather than, I'm going to keep moving toward you because I'm doing this because of my trust for Christ and my desire to be an instrument in his hands, even though it's not being reciprocated.
So this question just got tweeted to us. Should I ever withhold grace? Should I ever withhold grace if I perceive that someone, let's say that child or that spouse, is, as it were, taking advantage of it?
Well, my first thought is I'm very thankful Jesus doesn't withhold grace at the places where I take advantage of it. Oh, my goodness, I would be cooked. Thank you. See, I think that really what I'm doing is I'm aware of two kinds of grace. There's the grace of relief and release, where in mercy I lift the person's burden. But there's another kind of grace that's mentioned in the New Testament. It's uncomfortable grace. It's where I understand you need to face some of the consequences of your choices. I'm not doing that punitively. I'm not doing that because I'm mad at you and I'm going to sting you. The model of discipline in Hebrews, God's discipline of us, is that the Father disciplines us in order to produce a harvest of righteousness. It's restorative, corrective grace. So I have that burden-lifting grace. I'll give you mercy at this moment, even though you haven't earned it. And there are other times in wisdom, I think, you need to taste a little bit of your foolishness. Now, I'm doing that in grace because I want that to be a restorative tool. I'm not saying, you're going to treat me this way? You're going to use me? You're going to take advantage of me? I'll show you. Try me. Because that's a whole different model. That's thinking that by the sting of the law, I can produce heart change. And that's a different gospel. Doesn't work.
All right, well, I don't know how many children or how many young people might be watching the broadcast tonight, and we hope that there's many. But this next tweet came in, I'm guessing, Paul, from a young person, and they ask this. Dear Paul Tripp, is it ever appropriate to confront your parents when you know that they have sinned or when you think that they have sinned? How does a young person honor their father and mother and obey their parents, and yet confront them when their parents have fallen into sin? Is there a time to do that?
I think it's very, very important for a young person, child, to realize that you live in a world of authority. And so authority works this way. In authority, you command down and you appeal up. So you never want to approach your parents in a way that is an attempt to take authority over them. Because that blurs something that God set up that's for your good. You need that authority in your life. This authority is an independent of the parent. This authority is representative, and it represents God's authority in your life. Now, having said that, I think there's a very, very respectful way of doing that. I came home one evening. My son, Ethan, was about 15 years old. I will never forget this. It was such a wonderful moment of grace for me. And I had been building a case against him for some things that I was observing at a bit of a distance. And I came in, I saw him, and I just went after him. It was a bit of a parental machine gun. And he just listened. He was respectful at the moment. He didn't argue with me. And I prayed with him as a good godly father would. And I said, "It's been great talking to you." We went on with our evening, and after dinner, maybe a couple hours after dinner, he wandered up to my room. I was actually doing some writing in my bedroom, and he said, "Dad, can we talk?" And I said, "Sure, sure." He said, do you remember tonight when we had that talk?" I said, "Sure." He said, "I hope you don't mind me saying this, but you ended it by saying it was nice talking to you." "I didn't talk, Dad. You never asked me a question. You never asked me what I was thinking. You had made a bunch of assumptions, and you judged me on that basis. And I know it wasn't your desire to hurt me, but that hurt me. And you prayed and walked away, and I had no opportunity to say, 'Dad, I agree with you, but I think you've misread the situation.'" Well, that wasn't him taking authority over me. It was very loving, very respectful. I cried as he talked to me. Not because I was embarrassed that my son was talking to me, but just the conviction of the Spirit of God, and realized that he was speaking into a pattern of mine that was bigger than just him. I'm a thinker. I analyze things, and it's easy for me to make conclusions too quick. That was a wonderful moment. Very respectful, not inappropriate in any way. I am very thankful that he loved me enough to come back upstairs, because he could have just blown it off. Said, that's my old man. He knows he goes off half-cocked, and I'm just going to have to live with it. So I think there's a very appropriate way to do that.
And in your case, I mean, that's an evidence of grace on the move in the Tripp household.
Absolutely.
Was that the kind of thing that you tried to foster more of than first time, obviously, heartbreaking and whatnot? But did that change some of your own parenting techniques then with your other kids and with him down the road, where you were welcoming of that kind of, not pushback, but that kind of respectful dialogue about incidents like that?
It sort of has become...
Did you take advantage of it down the road? Sure. And come back at you a few more times?
I think it has actually become a bigger paradigm for me. I think that the Christian life is just an endless conversation. I approach you with I hope, the humility of approachability and the courage of loving honesty. And you approach me with the humility of approachability and the courage of loving honesty. And we're just constantly talking. And I don't get my identity from you being stunned by how glorious I am, and you don't get yours that way. And so we just can have this ongoing conversation. And so, sure, I can give an example of that. A couple children down, we're driving home from church, and I'm sniping at Luella for her driving. And my son Darnay, 17, sitting in the back seat, says, "Can I comment?" He said, "Dad, maybe it's not so much mom's driving. Maybe it's just your idolatry." And again, that's become conversation for us. I wasn't offended by that. And I said, "What do you mean?" He says, "Would you just like to control things kind of, you know. Well, it's wonderful. Mm. He's not taking authority over me because we've welcomed those kinds of conversations. So surely, that became something important.
Okay. I think that's an interesting aspect to think about, whether there would be parents hearing you talk about this that would feel maybe more than just uncomfortable with that, but for their child or their teenager to come back at them, it would be threatening.
Yeah, well, I want to say something about that. I don't want to give the impression that it was always easy.
Okay.
I mean, we went through periods of time where talking was hard. And where walls go up for a while, and where I'm not always responding in the same way. But that's the messiness that grace speaks into. You don't panic and say, well, it's not working and we're cooked. You just again say, for this we have Christ. The gospel speaks into this moment. We got to get up and do what is right.
Okay. All right, well, let's talk about a more of a specific question that has come in now in various forms from our viewing audience. The issue of spanking. You mentioned earlier that, you know, loving discipline. Just talk about this issue of spanking. You mentioned earlier about we don't want to be punitive in how we correct our children, and certainly we don't want to correct our children in anger. But several folks commenting on, what do you think about spanking? Is there a place for it? How does that play? Does the child translate that paddle into law? And does that go against what you were saying earlier about trying to bring change about through the use of the law?
Yeah, I think it's a wonderful question. I want to say this as strongly as I can say it. I want the people who are tuning in to hear this. I think all forms of shoving, pushing, pinching, poking, slapping, yanking, it's abusive. It must stop. I think there's a whole lot of abuse going on in the name of Christian discipline, and it's wrong, and it's harming the souls of our children. Because if in a flash of a moment you slap a child, if a flash in a moment you pinch a child, you yank a child, you poke, you push, you pull hair, whatever it is, that cannot be restrained, grace-driven, loving discipline. It just can't be. It's spontaneous, ugly, self-oriented, angry abuse. It's what it is. Now, having said that, there is this beautiful thing that God has set up. It's captured in that wonderful passage in Proverbs where foolishness is bound up in the heart of a child and the rod of correction will drive it far from him. Here's what's going on. Although I've given birth to a child who in the image of God has sophisticated sort of interpretive abilities, a young child is not able to fully understand the consequences of his foolishness. Foolishness is dangerous because, first of all, it's God-denying. And then the fool sees the world inside out, upside down. A fool looks at truth and sees falsehood. He looks at wise and sees unwise. Looks at good and sees bad. Looks at true and sees false. A fool has it all mixed up. So what the scripture is actually saying is there is this danger that's lurking in the heart of this child. It's the foolishness of sin. But because he's of limited experience and a still developing conceptual ability, he doesn't have the ability to grasp the implications of his foolishness. Mm-hmm. So God's done a wonderful thing. He's designed this system where an act of foolishness is followed by a painful physical consequence, a restrained, godly, careful, I'm not meeting out my anger against the child, I'm not seeking to injure the child, but I'm trying to connect that momentary pain with that act of foolishness so the child begins to conclude, When I do foolish things, bad things happen. And that connection begins, is meant by God to cause the child to begin to be concerned about this foolishness inside of him, which makes him then a seeker after the wisdom that he can only find in God. I mean, it's a gorgeous thing. So the way that I do that is very, very important. If you want to be a part of heart-delivering discipline, you have to start with your own heart. Because if it's done in anger, in the spontaneity of a moment, then it doesn't accomplish what it's accomplished. And what happens is, if discipline is the result of my anger, it won't be uniform. Because sometimes I won't be as angry as others. And so children, instead of learning God's law, which is meant to be a schoolmaster to lead them to Christ, they become skilled weathermen. They learn to read the emotional weather of the family. You can find kids talking to their parents, talking to one another about their parents. How's Dad doing tonight? Or Mom's not doing well. Well, that's that insecure system of an anger-driven kind of discipline that's not uniform, and so we read the weather instead of a form of discipline that's saying much more about us than it is about our parents. And telling me things about me that I need to learn. And as I learn those things, I get growingly concerned about what's inside of me and begin to seek the help of Christ.
Is there an age at which parents should be transitioning out of that type of discipline method, whether it's the teen years or tween years or older elementary school age? Or is it really depend on the personality, the temperament, the character of the child?
Yeah, I think there are a lot of variables, but I think there may come a couple things. You know, the process may need some disrobing to be effective, and it may get to the point where that becomes enough of an issue that you think we're moving beyond this. Or most often, the child now is able to see the consequences of his foolishness. We're able to have those conversations. We're able to attach discipline to consequences in ways we couldn't before that are effective. We're able to have more redemptive conversations with a child, and it seems like we've moved beyond the area. But there's not a given age. It's a judgment call. And you know, I want to say that this needs to be effective. Again, you're not trying to injure the child. But if the child is wearing Oshkosh Bagosh overalls and three layers of diapers, you could shoot the child in the rear end and he wouldn't feel it. Right. So, you know, you have to be aware of what God has designed, but it needs to be an act of love, not an act of irritation or anger, because that discipline is meant to be restorative, not punitive.
Mm-hmm. Okay, very, very helpful. Well, we're going to have one more question about parenting before we take a short break. And by the way, this first segment just happened to end up being a lot of questions about parenting. And we've had some of these in queue that you've sent in, and some of these have happened during the broadcast. Feel free to keep those questions coming. We're going to probably move on to some other topics as well in the time that remains. But one more question on the parenting issue before we go to a short break, Paul. And it is simply this. When you look out of the camera and you've got a mom or a dad or a set of parents that their comment to you, if they could come into the studio tonight and say one thing to you, it would be this. You know, Paul, I walk around day by day with basically a low-grade sense of guilt that I'm not doing it good enough, that I'm making mistakes, that my kids are growing up like weeds before my eyes. And they're going to be out of the home sooner than I thought, and there's so much work to do. When I think of parenting, I'm not filled with joy. I'm filled with more of a sense of how I'm failing at it. What do you say to that viewer or that parent tonight?
I would say a couple things. One is the amazing truth of the movement of the gospel and the movement of the kingdom of God is God always uses broken instruments. I still consider myself a bit of a mess, and I'm daily rescued by God's grace. that God has this powerful ability to take flawed people and use them as instruments of His grace. The second thing I would say is that God will never call you to a task without enabling you to do what He's called for you to do. That there is grace for all of those realities. I actually think it's better for a parent to say, this is way beyond me, and I need grace every day to be a good parent. I would rather live with that parent than the parent who says, I've got this knocked, watch me work. And then again, I think you do what God's called you to do, not because of your track record, or not because of the size of what you're facing, but because of who Christ is and what He's promised you. That I really do believe in the presence and the promises and the provisions of Christ. I get up in the morning and I am going to be faithful to my children, not because I see fruit, but because I believe Christ is faithful. I believe His word is true, and I'm going to press on. And that's a gospel you have to preach to yourself every day, because every day is full of new challenges. This is this world is a broken place. These are sinner children. This is spiritual warfare. But there is no pit so deep that Jesus isn't deeper.
Amen. Amen. Well, on that note, we are going to take a brief 5-minute break. Go grab a cup of coffee. Go let the dog out. We'll come back here in 5 minutes. Thank you. You're watching Ask Paul Tripp Live here from the Desiring God Studios in Minneapolis, Minnesota. We'll be back in 5 minutes. Well, welcome back to our night here with Paul Tripp, live in the Desiring God Studios here in Minneapolis, Minnesota. Thank you for joining us tonight, and you're welcome to participate in this Ask Paul Tripp night. Simply hop on Twitter and tweet us your questions, and we encourage you to use the hashtag AskPT. So #AskPT. Our crew will see those. I'm huddled over this laptop as well. They're vetting some of these questions and sending them my way. And then, Paul, we turn around and ask them to you. So in our first segment, we covered a lot of questions on parenting, really stemming off of some comments made about Paul's book, The Age of Opportunity. And keep those questions coming in as well. We're going to move to some different topics here in just a little bit, but we're going to also ask some more parenting questions as well. So keep the questions coming in, and we'll keep them going at you. If you are just joining us, again, this is our 10th broadcast from the studios here. Normally we have John Piper in here, and we're asking him questions for a couple of hours. And tonight's really special for us to be able to have Paul with us. So thanks for being here. And thank you for watching as well. So we talked about this book from Crossway Books earlier. This is Paul's new book called What Did You Expect? Redeeming the Realities of Marriage. And just during the break, we decided to make this even more interactive and interesting for the viewers out there. We want to give this book away. Paul will sign this book, and Desiring God will send it out to you. And here's all we ask. If you're out there and you're a married couple and your anniversary is this week, if your anniversary is tonight, let us know. But if your anniversary is this week, just tweet us and use the #AskPT. And if there's more than one of you married couples that are celebrating an anniversary this week, we'll make sure we get you all a copy of this book. We want to give this away to you. So go ahead and tweet those in right now. And I guess if we get 150 anniversaries this week, then we'll send out 150 books. But Paul, this is a really interesting book, and I think it's going to be helpful for many, many married couples. So let's talk a little bit just about why did you write the book, and if you could summarize that book in kind of a one answer here, kind of a nutshell, a silver bullet. Why did you write that book, and really, what is the core of that book about?
I have to make this confession. I'm a man who's written a marriage book who sort of hates marriage books. I haven't been a real avid reader of marriage books. And here's why. That I think often marriage books cover the turf of roles and communication and sex and parenting and finances and in-laws, those kinds of things. And I think those are important topics, but here's what my observation would be. Those are not the cause of marriage difficulty. Okay. Those are the location where marriage difficulty demonstrates itself. Mm-hmm. That I think the war of marriage is at a deeper level. And I would say it that it's that here's the war. It's an everyday war between the kingdom of self and the kingdom of God. 2 Corinthians 5:15 says this, that Jesus came so that those who live would no longer live for themselves. Now, you're going to have to let me do this. The DNA of sin is selfishness. Sin causes me to want to live in the center of my world. Sin causes me to want to shrink my life down to my wants, my needs, my feelings. That means that sin, wow, this is important, is fundamentally antisocial. Because I was meant to live in these two communities, a community of loving worship of God, a community of interdependent love of neighbor. Sin turns me in on myself. I don't actually love you. I like you in my life if you're loving me as much as I love me. If you're helping me get what I want, if you're serving the purposes of my kingdom. So that means a third thing, that sin causes me to dehumanize the people in my life because they quit being objects of my affection. They become either vehicles or obstacles. If they're helping me get what I want, I love them, cards and flowers. If they stand in the way of what I want, I'm spontaneously angry. Now, when you get two people who are willing to say, we're about to get radical and I'm about to hurt people's feelings, when they say, I am my greatest marriage problem, my biggest marriage difficulty isn't what I'm going to suffer at the hands of that other person. My biggest marriage problem is me. I have something lurking inside of me that's fundamentally destructive to relationships, first. And for this, I have Jesus. Then, all of a sudden, we are denying the kingdom of self, and we're finding our hope in the larger kingdom of God. We're now both seeking the help of the same King. So what happens is this marriage of unity, understanding, and love isn't actually rooted in romance, it's rooted in worship. Because the devastation of our confidence in self drives us to seek God, to worship Him for His grace. That propels the unity of the marriage. That's what this book is about. It's very, very honest. It's very honest about everybody's struggle. I can say this about every marriage that's represented out there, that there's nobody in any marriage who hasn't been disappointed in some way. Isn't that stunning? And into that brokenness, this diagnostic gospel that says, it's you. It's your desire to have your own kingdom, your desire to be a little self-sovereign, your desire to have it your way, and your tendency to co-opt that person into the service of your kingdom, that is the mess of marriage.
We'll talk a little bit. It sounds like there's a little bit of a corrective you're bringing in the book in terms of a new mindset, a new way of viewing marriage. But the book deals with unrealistic expectations. And so whether you're watching tonight and you're married and you've experienced many of those unrealistic expectations, or whether it's a single person out there who's got these idealistic expectations of what marriage ought to be, just what are some of the more unrealistic expectations that people have going into marriage that we need to be aware of?
Well, let me start by saying how it happens. You know, in the power of attraction and romance that's always often part of courtship, it's very easy to think these scintillating feelings that you're experiencing are sturdy enough to keep you from the dangers that other people have fallen into. I would be sitting with a couple getting ready to be married. I'd be the one doing the premarital counseling, and they'd be looking at one another with what I'd call Google eyes, you know. And somewhere the future bride would say, I don't think I could ever be angry at him. I'm angry just to hear it. Because I think, you got to be kidding me. And so what I think is, we have something special because of the power of these feelings that we have that will keep us from experiencing these kinds of things that other people experience. Well, it's just not true. Because here's a biblical view of marriage. Here it is, very easy. It's a flawed person married to a flawed person in a fallen world. Are you encouraged yet? But with a faithful God. I never get to marry a non-sinner. You never have a non-sinner married a non-sinner. And we never get to live in a perfect world. So all of that messiness that's described, all the propensities of sin, all the propensities of a fallen world, we have to conclude in the kinds of realistic thoughts we have about what we will encounter in marriage. That doesn't mean we're dark and cynical, because we believe in the power of the gospel, we believe in the rescuing, enabling, forgiving work of Christ, but we're realistic. This is what this means. As a young bride, I may know that my husband's going to have a bad day. He's going to be full of himself at moments. He's going to be unforgiving. He's going to say an unkind thing. I'm prepared for that. The man thinks, this is not a perfect woman. She's not going to behave. She's not going to desire. She's not going to talk always perfectly. And this is what I mean in the book by this principle of prepared spontaneity. That I don't know exactly when the trouble's going to come, but I've got my gospel thinking on. I know who we are. I know what we need. I know the habits that we have to do in order to be in a good place. So when the moment comes, although I couldn't have told you it was coming, I'm already prepared for it. Because the Bible has oriented me to a right set of expectations and a right set of habits.
Okay, very, very helpful. You know, I want to interject this comment right now. As we've prayed about this broadcast, we want these 2 hours to be a tremendous blessing for everyone that might be tuning in tonight. And so maybe there's folks here that have, maybe you're watching this as a married couple tonight, and you're hoping to come away with something, a tactic or a technique or a methodology that God would speak to you. That's a wonderful thing. But we often talk at DG in terms of sentences that you read in a book or sentences that somebody says that can really just lock something in place in your mind or your heart. And in Paul's last answer, I just want to, Paul, cover this again. You know, this is a helpful sentence. Marriage is a flawed person and a flawed person in a broken world, but a faithful God. Our hope tonight is that little snippets like that might be profoundly helpful in adjusting all of our reality to these issues of parenting and marriage and things like that.
I want to follow up, because I think this would be helpful, how that the selfishness of sin creates a dynamic of faux love.
Talk about that.
Let me take the part of a young woman who has a dream for her life. She sort of knows what she would like her narrative to be. That's that sort of self-kingdom stuff. All of us do that in some way. And she's actually thought of a man who would fit into the puzzle that's her dream. And she finds this guy. He fits. He's the final puzzle piece. She doesn't even have to bend the tabs. And now, get what I'm going to say next. She's powerfully attracted to him. But this needs to be said. She's not attracted to him because she loves him. She's attracted to him because she loves her. And she loves what he will do for her. She doesn't love him warts, weaknesses, sin, messiness, and all, because that's all been ferreted out of her thinking. At the same time, the guy is experiencing this powerful attraction because I'm now around a woman who thinks I'm the finest thing since spreadable peanut butter. How energizing is that? And so this attraction, this magnetic thing that is basically thinking, I'm going to get my kingdom dream, is not love, because it's all self-oriented. It's not that willing self-sacrifice for the good of another, even though they can't reciprocate, they're not deserving. So the problem is attraction isn't sturdy enough to bear the weight of the difficulties of marriage. Because there will come a moment in marriage where that person isn't attractive to you. You know, you wake up one morning and you're laying next to a person who has robin nest hair. You even think you see birds. And they roll over and greet you with zoo breath. Why they're telling you that they're never going to take out the trash again. At that moment, attraction is not going to carry the freight. And what people begin to say is, perhaps we don't love one another anymore. Well, maybe that's actually more accurate than they think. Maybe they never did. We have had on our marriage weekends the experience of long-term married couples in troubled marriages who would confess to coming to love them, one another the very first time that weekend. Because they get it, that what got them into the relationship and that what has propelled their dismay is the dream. Hear this, the dream gets me into the marriage, but the dream creates my despondency in marriage because I hit the wall, I'm not getting my dream. And then I begin to think, what do? I'm now stuck with this person. Well, that's when the love of Christ alone has the power to produce in you real love of that person and a real turnaround of that relationship. But I think there are many couples who have mistaken the power of that kind of attraction for what the Bible would call love. And they're really two different things.
So, Paul, is there a sense in which the dream, as you put it, of falling in love is a gift of grace, but God uses then the shattering of that dream also as a gift of grace to help then birth a deeper love or a more real love within that married couple, that married unit?
Hear my story. I was dating Luella. I was looking for this moment to tell her that I loved her. I was convinced that I was deeply, fully in love with this woman. The right moment came. I thought I would hear birds sing, violins play. I said to Luella, "Luella, I love you." She said to me, "You what? You love me? What do you know about love? Don't ever say that to me again. I heard birds dying, violins breaking." Now, I want to say this. I want people to hear me say this. I look back, she was absolutely right. I had little of an understanding of what love is actually about. And my marriage has been a lifelong process of learning to love Luella. Not because of Luella, but because of me. So if you're in marriage and you say, man, I think this man is talking to us, God's got you right where he wants you. It's not time to get out of your marriage. It's a call to believe in the transforming power of the gospel, that God is alerting you to this, not so you'll panic and run, but so that you'll become a person of love.
Does that dynamic hold true, Paul, for those that are married to an unbeliever? Is there a sense in which any of what you just said would change fundamentally if one of the spouses is a believer and one of the spouses is an unbeliever? That question just coming to us from Twitter.
Well, can I get even more radical in my answer?
Get radical. We love radical.
This will upset ladies who are watching, perhaps. But the way you define need in your marriage is very important. If need means essential for life, you don't actually need a husband who loves you. God never promises you that. What He promises you is Himself. Is that a wonderful thing to desire? It sure is. Is it something you should pray for? It surely is. Is it something you should work to? It sure should. But if you tell yourself that's a need, then you think it's impossible for you to be godly if you don't have that. And what you're actually doing is you're turning a blessing into a demand. You think you're entitled to it, you think it's your right to demand it, and you think somehow you've been ripped off because you don't have it. And there are many women in troubled marriages whose deeper struggle is that God hasn't been faithful to them. God, for the purpose of His sovereignty, for the purpose of His own glory, for the purpose of His kingdom, may put you in a less than comfortable marriage. God's God. Now, what He promises is Himself, that He will be for you everything you need in that situation. But there isn't a blanket promise that all godly women will have godly husbands, or all godly men will have serving and respectful wives. It's just not there.
Okay. Well, back to the book a little bit. Paul, you talk about use the metaphor of gardening. And so I got kind of a twofold question related to that. First of all, just talk about weeds in the garden, the weeds that can hinder marriage or the weeds that can be so noxious that they have long-term damaging effects at the start of a healthy marriage.
Well, I like to say that the metaphor isn't mine. I mean, it comes from Jeremiah. Mm-hmm. When God called Jeremiah, He said, I call you to uproot and to plant. Mm-hmm. If you're going to have a beautiful garden, you have to recognize the difference between flowers and weeds. And you have to get rid of the weeds, or they'll choke out your flowers. And no good gardener ever weeds his garden once. Weeding is an ongoing commitment. Mm-hmm. So what are the weeds that choke the life out of a marriage? Well, they're pretty simple. Selfishness, power and control, condemning spirit, unforgiveness, bitterness, actions that break down trust, unfaithfulness. Now, what I would like to say is, as I say those words to people, I think this is very, very important to say, that the character of a marriage is not formed in three big dynamic moments. We don't live in big moments. Most of us won't be written up in history books. Several decades after we die, the people we leave behind will struggle to remember the events of our lives. We live in the mundane. And if God doesn't rule your mundane, it doesn't rule you. So the character of a marriage is not formed in three big moments. It's formed in 10,000 little moments. This is where I think we get in trouble. Because there'll be a nasty moment of needless criticism. And I'll walk away and say, but she knows I love her. It was just a little moment. There'll be an angry moment of selfishness. and the person will walk away and save it. He knows I love him. It was just a little moment. We back away from the fact that all weeds start little. It's like the gardener said, I don't need to weed this week. And by the next week, he can't find his flowers. That's what we do. And so you've got to have a grace-driven, Christ-centered, redemptive, hopeful work ethic. You got to weed the garden again and again and again. And that means having an economy in your marriage, a relationship in your marriage, where you can just talk about this stuff. Where I've welcomed you to come to me and say, you know, that was a pretty nasty comment. And we've talked about it. We've committed ourselves to this. And I don't say, yeah, well, I'm not the only sinner in the room. Where I welcome that. I'm thankful for that. I want to have that kind of relationship with you. Mm. So those are weeds. Seeds, confession and forgiveness. Mm. Constant lifestyle, confession and forgiveness. Committed to a growth and change agenda. Mm. Building trust. Doing things that build trust, committing ourselves to practical love, working to protect our relationship. Those are all seeds that you plant that bear good fruit.
So weeds and seeds. And we got to weed the garden, and we've got to seed the garden. All right.
Yeah, and it's practical. So, for example, if I want to build a relationship with love, I ask myself the question, who is this woman that I'm married to? What are her pressures, her burdens? Where does she tend to get discouraged? Where could I serve her? How can I encourage her? I get specific and concrete. I look for particular daily ways to love her. And I'm developing a base of knowledge because I live with her, but that's intentional, it's ongoing, it's perseverant, it's planting good seeds.
Okay. Let's talk about this issue that you mentioned earlier, Paul. Marriage is rooted in worship, or marriage is worship. That's got to be a new metaphor for a lot of people, a new concept. So can you just unpack that a little bit? What do you mean when you say marriage is worship, or is rooted in worship?
Sure.
And then what does that look like practically?
Yeah, I think that worship in our culture has become a tricky word.
Okay.
Because we've formalized the concept, and probably a lot of people hearing me talk, when they hear the word worship, they think a service, a gathering. They think Sunday morning. They think singing, an offering, and preaching. And what you need to understand is that worship is first your identity before it's ever your activity. You are a worshiper. You actually don't worship at some points in your life. You worship your way through life. That means that you're always getting your identity, your meaning and purpose, your inner sense of well-being from something. And there are only two places to look. You're looking to the Creator, and your deepest sense of security, your deepest sense of satisfaction, your deepest sense of meaning and purpose, your deepest sense of inner well-being is gotten vertically, or you're shopping for that horizontally. Let me give you two examples of how that impacts marriage. If I'm a woman, which I'm not, the mustache gives that away, and I'm seeking to get my meaning and purpose, my inner sense of peace, well-being, from the orderliness and cleanliness of my house. Unwittingly, I've turned my house into a museum to my domestic dexterity. Now, what is that going to cause? It's going to cause me to be uptight, hypervigilant, irritable, in the face of anyone in that house actually making that place look like it's lived in. That becomes a personal affront. That's why people say, how could you do this to me? And that house has risen to a level of importance far beyond any importance that it actually has, because it is the thing that gives me meaning and purpose. I would say it this way: this side of eternity, it's very hard to keep what is truly important important in your life. Mm-hmm. Things rise to a level of importance way beyond what they actually are. I'll give you another example. Let's say I'm a man and I get my identity from my job. It's where I feel alive, it's where I feel powerful, it's where I get meaning. What's happening to me as I'm driving away from the job toward my home? I'm leaving the place where I feel alive and get identity. No wonder when I get home, I just want to be left alone. So there's two very concrete examples that a marriage is always shaped by worship. Now watch this. You have this broken man who doesn't always get it right, this broken woman who doesn't always get it right, but who are looking to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the Savior, the Lamb, to get their deepest identity, their deepest meaning and purpose, their deepest sense of well-being. As they move toward Him, by the very nature of that, they're moving toward one another. So I'm freed from leaning on you for that. I've had thousands of wives say to me, all I ever wanted was a husband who would make me happy. I think, well, that man's cooked. Because he should nourish and cherish you, he cannot be the source of your inner happiness. No flawed man will ever pull that off. And those are burdens too big for a marriage to bear. I think this principle means that often in ways that we don't understand, we're asking our marriage to be our own personal Messiah and won't ever work. The house won't do that. The kids won't do that. The experiences we have together won't do that. My mate won't do that. Only Jesus can give me what I'm seeking.
Excellent.
That's why I said earlier, you start with, this is who you are in Jesus. And now this is what you do as you believe that.
Paul, what would you say to the viewer tonight that is hearing this, and maybe they've read it before in your books, they believe it, they're trying to practice it, but they've got a spouse that is unaware of it, or a spouse that's not on board with it? It's not how they communicate, it's not how kind of they, is there a way to kind of win and woo that spouse over to this openness and this gospel-centeredness in a marriage, whether it's the husband or the wife needing to do that?
Well, I could answer this by a story. My grandmother on my mom's side was a very sweet and committed believer. She didn't throw the gospel in arrogant ways and condemning ways in front of her husband, but she lived the grace of Jesus in very, very clear ways. She was blind. Suffered through her adult years, but she lived in joy of Christ, just a deep sense of privilege that she was His child, knowing that she had eyes to see the most beautiful things anyone could ever see, the truths of the gospel of Jesus. She was clear-sighted. And my grandfather was an ugly man. He was abusive, he was condemning, he was hurtful. As children, we dreaded going to their house because he always did hurtful things to us. At 76, he came to Christ. And I'll never forget when he was being baptized, he said, I could critique the theology of the church. I could make fun of its programs. I could say the offering was a dead giveaway about what the church was about. But he pointed to her, he said, I could not fight the life of this woman. And he said, her life is what finally brought him to the point where he thought, I don't know what I think about all that teaching. I don't know about all that, but but I want what this woman has. I think that is very powerful. Now, is that a guarantee? No, it's not. But if I can be used in any way by my commitment and my obedience of Christ to soften the heart of a spouse, what a beautiful thing that would be.
Okay. You know, in this culture that we live in, and there's seems to be a greater emphasis on the issue of authenticity and transparency, kind of putting your feelings out there. That probably has some good things that go along with it and maybe some not so good things. It's permeating the church and things like that. Talk about that dynamic of needing to be authentic and transparent and honest, is maybe a better word, in our marriages, including honesty about our sin. To what extent do we let that kind of seep out? Is it something we keep within our marriage? Do we share it with our children? Is it something that we go ahead and leak to our care group, our church body? Can we be too authentic? Is there a privacy factor that certain things just struggles in marriage need to be kept contained in the smallest circle possible? Or does the gospel free us to broadcast that really to whomever we want?
I think what's helpful here is what the scripture says about I should always speak in a wholesome way words that give grace, that build, that edify the hearer. I think honesty can be very selfish. It could be the selfishness of vengeance. I'm going to hurt you by honesty. It could be the selfishness of self-atonement. I'm going to cleanse myself by honesty. It can be the selfishness of sort of laziness. I'm tired of carrying the burden, and so I'm just going to dump it on you. That's ungodly honesty, because it's not considering you. It's not giving grace to those who hear. Now, I think because sin blinds, and I still have sin inside of me, that having relationships of honesty where I can talk about myself and you can help me see myself with greater clarity is a good thing. But I always have to do that considering you. I always want to, in those moments, to be an instrument of the Holy Spirit working on everybody in the room. I think honesty can be titillating. It's sort of masked the excitement of sin, and we can sort of get it out there, and all that stuff is just not healthy. So the answer is no. Honesty is not just, let's just be open no matter what. On the other hand, there is a call to confess faults to one another. And there is the ministry of the body of Christ. And there is the fact that often personal insight is the result of community. It's hard for me to get it myself.
Helpful.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, before we cut to another short break here, Paul, I want you to, this will be a special little gift, let's say, for maybe our married couples that are watching tonight, or those that may watch this down the road together. I want you to maybe look out into the camera tonight, and if there's a married couple that maybe after this break they need to shut the computer down and they need to go away, is there a verse, or is there a question, or is there a spiritual discipline or practice? Is there one thing that couple could go away tonight with, and ask tonight, quote to one another tonight, that might really bless them and be meaningful to them? Is there kind of one comment or question that you could make that tonight our viewers could just go away with, turn to each other, and talk about this that might really help their marriage? What would that thing be tonight?
I want to encourage you to pray an early morning, everyday prayer, almost everyday prayer for me. You can pray it as a couple. I'll put it in a couple form. Three prayers. The first prayer is, Lord, we're a couple in desperate need of help this evening. That's a prayer that confesses sin and honors the grace of Christ. Second prayer is, we pray that in your grace, you would send your helpers our way. Mm-hmm. It's a prayer for the resources that God provides for his people. The third prayer is, and I think this is very important, and Lord, please give us the humility to receive the help mm-hmm. when it comes. Those prayers are at the heart of Jesus. Mm-hmm. He calls you to confess mm-hmm. sin. He welcomes you into the community of the body of Christ. And he offers you the grace that is necessary mm-hmm. to face your sin in ways that are humble.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Thanks, yeah. Paul. Well, we're going to take another short break, 5 minutes, and then we'll come back for our last segment here with Paul Tripp, live from Minneapolis tonight. We'll see you in 5 minutes. Thank you. Welcome back, and thank you for joining us for this third segment of our Ask Paul Tripp live broadcast from the Desiring God Studios here in Minneapolis, Minnesota. We'd like to welcome those of you that are just joining us for this segment. Thanks for being a part of it, and for any of you that would like to participate in this conversation, we encourage you to go ahead and submit your questions to us via Twitter. So just send that question off and then use the hashtag #AskPT, #AskPT, and that'll get to us here. Those are all being kind of culled and vetted by a team here on the other side of the wall and then brought over to me here, and we're having just really a great time, and I think a really helpful time, Paul, tonight.
Good.
In our first segment, we covered a lot of the issues pertaining to parenting and being a gospel-centered and gospel-driven parent. In the second segment, we covered, I think, exclusively questions on marriage and how do we work through the brokenness of our marriages in this life. And Paul, let's go to this issue as we start this third segment. Just talk to us about, in marriage, why is it that God sticks flawed with flawed in a broken world kind of a thing? Couldn't have he done it a little differently? Or talk about the slowness of sanctification, how that grates on us as married people.
One of the things that, I mean, it makes sense to think that why does God put the world's most demanding and comprehensive relationship, marriage, in the middle of the world's most important incomplete process, sanctification? Mm-hmm. Wouldn't it have been better to get us fully sanctified first? If I could marry a fully sanctified wife and God would throw in self-parenting children, that would be cool.
That's right.
Now, the reason we think that is we're oriented to comfort and ease, predictability. We're oriented to temporal, personal happiness. And that's not a bad thing. God's wired us for glory. But it can be a distorted thing. Could it be that God is working on something more satisfying and more beautiful than that? This thing called holiness. That when I live in created design of that orderliness with God, that submission to God, that worship to God, I experience the deepest of joys, the deepest of fulfillments. That's what God is driving me toward. And so, why the messiness of marriage? Marriage is meant to drive you beyond yourself. It's meant to do that. And it does it. To drive you beyond your wisdom, beyond your strength, beyond your righteousness. Here's why. True righteousness only ever begins when you come to the end of yourself. It's self-reliance, reliance on self-wisdom, self-strength, self-righteousness that is in the way of the very thing that God is offering us. I don't need it because I think I'm fine. And so what God does is proves in marriage how unfine you actually are. Because I realize it's not just that I don't love my enemies. I don't love the people I say I love, that I willingly chose to spend my life with, that I was attracted to, that at some levels I adore. I'm creepy, mean, critical, picky. I mean, think about the things we fight in about. A woman will say, I can't believe I'm married to a man who drops his towel
on the floor in the bathroom.
Well, that's a big issue.
My dad was a dropper. I didn't think I'd ever marry a dropper.
Well, it's not like that thing doesn't have any significance, but that's how self-oriented, how picky I can be. And so God brings me to the end of myself so that I will find hope and confidence in Him. So the order is right, because we need to be in situations where we're pushed beyond the boundaries of that selfism, so we cry out for the help of a Redeemer, and we begin to find our hope in Him.
So maybe one of the reasons why broken marriages exist in a fallen world is so that we might set our hope in God.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I am deeply grateful for the travails of my marriage. I wouldn't want to repeat those things again. I'm deeply grateful for what has been revealed to me. I'm deeply grateful for a wife who didn't give up on me, but wouldn't let me get away with things, who would lovingly come to me, and for the God liberating me from me, rescuing me from me. In the context of marriage, a major, major tool of that has been my marriage.
Okay. Well, Paul, let's go to a couple issues that have come in on Twitter tonight and previous to prior to the broadcast as well, speaking of this issue of the need to be liberated by the gospel. Talk about this issue of just pornography in the home, in a marriage, in a family. As you're out, you're on the road, I don't know, 30-some weeks a year, it seems like now. Your event calendar's full. You're speaking at pastors' gatherings, large conferences, smaller family gatherings. I'm sure this issue is coming up. We've had a lot of questions about it. What I can do to break the power of that type of thing. You want to just, any comments on that subject? Is there a nugget or two that would be particularly helpful for the audience tonight on that issue?
Well, I think that we have to be sobered by the fact that we live in a culture that's gone sexually insane. There's no more sanity out there. I mean, we're using this gorgeous thing that's meant to be the expression of a long-term committed relationship between a man and a woman as entertainment, as a means of advertisement. We are so sexually obsessed that we're putting knives in the chests of our daughters and putting plasticine substances inside of them to give them a stronger sexual self. It's just craziness. And in a pleasure-driven culture, it makes sense to me that one of the idolatries of that culture would be sex. Because sex is such a quick pathway to pleasure. I mean, think about it. We're sexually addicted. We're food addicted. Were possession addicted. All of those were sort of achievement addicted, were experience addicted. Those are all quick buzz things. And so what that tells me is pornography is a false savior. Possessions are a false savior. Food is a false savior. I'm looking to get something. I'm looking to get this fulfillment of heart, this satisfaction, this joy from something that was never meant to do that for me. It's not what this thing is about. It will never work. It just leaves me addicted. So I think pornography isn't a root. It's a fruit of something deeper, that there's some kind of emptiness of heart. There's some kind of spiritual amnesia. There's some kind of desire inside of me that I'm looking to have fulfilled by this thing. I mean, take alcohol. Why do people drink? Well, addiction is not just about the substance. It's about a misuse of the substance. I'm using the substance for something that it was never meant to do for me. Maybe it's escape. Maybe it's I feel strong instead of weak, or I mean the list is endless. So I think you have to be aware that everything in the culture says it's all about finding the biggest, greatest, most satisfying set of affordable pleasures for you, because that's where happiness is to be found. That is an evil, twisted, dark, life-altering lie. It'll never happen, because the physical, organic world does not have the capacity to satisfy my heart. It doesn't. It wasn't designed to do that. All of the physical glories of creation are meant to be fingers to point me to the one satisfying glory, the glory of God. They're signs to point me to God's glory. And when they become the glory that captures me, it always leads to addiction. Why addiction? Because the buzz doesn't last long. You've got to go back, got to go back, got to go back. And what satisfied me yesterday, it doesn't satisfy today. So it's bigger, fuller, more. What does that argue for? It's not working. It can't fulfill your heart. So I would ask the question, what is beneath this compulsion in this man's life? My experience is that men who are captured, enslaved, addicted, whatever term you would use to pornography, have other things in their life that are functioning in the same way. That the bigger rubric is pleasure or fulfillment or satisfaction, and this is just one of the distorted ways that I'm seeking.
So
this.
The fruit, not the root, in evidence of something greater or deeper. Would the gospel pathway of freedom and liberation from that type of bondage be the same to other expressions of kind of our sexually insane culture, whether it's the person with homosexual desires that wants out of that, the person who's tempted toward pornography, other types of sexual deviance or marital infidelity? At root, there's something else going on that needs to be probed and dealt with by the gospel?
Here's your answer. It's Genesis 3. What was the evil trick of the enemy? He pointed at less and convinced Adam and Eve that it was more. And if Satan can point to less and tell you it's more, he's got you. So more is never found by stepping outside of God's boundaries. Never, ever, ever. I only ever get less. So Adam and Eve had everything that they needed. Satan offered them more. What was the more? Self-sufficient wisdom and autonomy from God. Well, that's not more, that's less, because I'm dependent on God's wisdom and I was wired for dependency on Him. So He points to less, convinces us that it's more, He's got us. And I will, again, it's very important to say, it doesn't matter what domain you're talking about, you never find spiritual life, personal, more outside of God's boundaries. Never, ever, ever. Now, what Satan does is he gets us so attracted, we play the boundaries. So we've got fence marks in our face, pressing at God's fences. Well, the person who's doing that may be inside God's boundaries, but he's still believing the lie. So I think there are many men in trouble who are not looking at pornography, but they're watching movies they shouldn't watch. They're watching television programs they shouldn't watch. They're overeating. They would rather spend $500 on a shotgun or a golf club than they would in service of God's kingdom. They're buying the same thing. They're still inside sort of the acceptable circle, but they're pushing their faces against the fence. They're believing the lie that the good stuff is out there.
You wrote a book called A Quest for More. Is that answer and what you've just been talking about, is that kind of at the root of that book And is that underneath, whether it's a man or a woman, whether it's a young person or an older person, whether it's a guy pushing 40 going through midlife crisis, or whether it's boomers that are about to retire and wondering what we do next, is that sort of a fundamental sin and unbelief issue down in the heart of everyone on this planet?
Yeah, I think it's universal.
Talk about that a little bit.
I think we've inherited the sin of Adam and Eve, and we tend to look horizontally for what only can be found vertically. And that makes us driven and crazy and discouraged and depressed and frustrated and controlling and angry and bitter and envious and jealous and sometimes satisfied but growingly addicted and in debt and fat and unhealthy and sexually crazy. It's a mess. Because those things will never be my Messiah. The Messiah is the Messiah. There's no other Messiah to be found. My heart won't rest because of those things. I tell the story of a boss who was a very, very successful man. I was his gardener. I worked on his estate. He had beautiful cars and way too many cars than he needed. And he drove in one day with a brand new car. And he said to me, "What do you think?" And I said, "I think it's not working." He said, "I don't know what you mean." I said, "I think what you're trying to do won't work." He says, "You're not making any sense to me at all." I said, "Benny, when are you going to realize that another automobile has no capacity whatsoever to satisfy your heart? How many cars will it take?" And he said, "Wow, you're raining on my parade." I was, big gospel monsoon.
Wonderful. All right. So for the person out here tonight who's watching this and saying, you know, this is great, Paul, and what you're saying is helpful, but you're also a veteran Christian counselor. You're a pastor. You've written books on this stuff. It's hard enough for me to just kind of imbibe this, as helpful as it is. I mean, that there's lifelong process right there. How in the world am I to turn around and do this for others? In other words, I want you to speak to this issue of being an instrument in the Redeemer's hand, to quote one of your book titles. Everything we've talked about tonight is something that God would want all of us to do, this lateral counseling, this conversation, this discipleship. Can you talk to the viewers tonight about how they don't have to be experts or professionals or perfect in order to live this out in redeeming ways, one with the other?
I could give you some names like Peter, Paul, for a couple. You know, I said to you in the break that when I have these conversations, I'm so thankful for my own travail that I really do minister out of my own brokenness. I sit here, Scott, I think it's very important for me to say, deeply aware that there's no answer I could ever give this evening that I don't desperately need myself, and that the war isn't over for me. I'm in the midst of those battles as much as anybody else is. And it's in the middle of those weaknesses, as God begins to work grace into you, that you learn lessons. You learn lessons that you can offer to others. Maybe that's the 1 Corinthians, God ordains for us to suffer so that our suffering will be able to comfort, so we can comfort others in their suffering. Mm-hmm. Paul turns and says, "I don't want you to be uninformed about the hardship we face in the province of Asia. We were far beyond our ability to endure. In our hearts we felt the sentence of death." Now you think about that. Mm-hmm. Crisis of faith in Paul's life doesn't sound like Paul. Okay. He'd been very self-disclosing in this moment. But he's able to minister with specificity precisely because he's not perfect, precisely because God has rescued him from him, and he's learned lessons of faith, lessons of warfare that he can now impart to others.
Okay. Can a believer spend too much time looking in, trying to fix? Do we need a gospel message that says, look in but look away, or look out and live, live, live? It seems like folks even tonight could end up kind of fixating on their own stuff, which is important, but is that an end in and of itself? Should we go there and remain there?
No patient in any hospital has ever been healed by diagnosis. Mm-hmm. Ever. If all the doctor did is diagnose you, you'd die. And that means that I'm never changed just by inner introspection. Mm-hmm. Jesus changes me. Mm-hmm. And it's the meditation on Christ, it's the running to Christ, it's the pursuit of Christ, mm-hmm. it's the study of the operation of His grace, it's place myself in the community of grace. It's all those outward moving, forward moving, courageous, hopeful, embracing of the gospel of grace that God uses to change me. Mm-hmm. Now, what happens is the more I'm aware of my sin, the more I pursue and appreciate grace. Mm-hmm. And the more I pursue and appreciate grace, the more I'm aware of sin. Mm-hmm. So there's a feedback loop there. But I think introspection can be dark and morose, mm-hmm. and defeating. It is the compelling glory of the grace of Christ that gets me up in the morning. Mm-hmm. And that makes me press on. And it's in the light of that glory that I see myself with accuracy. Mm-hmm. It's not just because I'm off in the corner in self-introspection. You know, it's sort of like if I got a stain in my shirt, the closer I get to the light, the more I'm able to see the stain.
Mm-hmm. And talk about practically then, what does that getting closer to the light look like? Are you talking the spiritual disciplines? Read your Bible, pray, go to church, take communion? Or is it, would you be concerned that people would jump off the Jesus track too quickly and run to, as it were, rote spiritual discipline? Just talk about that in your own life a little bit, how the spiritual disciplines have been helpful, but are you saying something else about rest in Jesus, dwell on Jesus, go to Jesus?
Yeah, I surely want to reinforce the significance of the means of grace. Mm-hmm. I travel almost every weekend. I do my best to fly home on Saturday so I can be in the service on Sunday morning, so I can worship with God's people, so I can be preached at. I think it's very, very important. I love the Lord's table. I love the remembrance that is there, the grace that's there. I love the fellowship of God's people. But I think there is something that goes alongside of all of those, and that's a self-conscious, personal communion with Christ. When I preach, I want my preparation of that message to be infected with my own communion with Christ, celebration of His Word, brokenheartedness at my failure to keep it, restored by His grace, all part of that preparation. It's not just a sort of academic discipline, can I get the exegesis right so I can feed that to God's people? Because I want people to watch me worship my way through the sermon, because I want Christ to be glorified by it. It's talking to Him all throughout my day. It's confessing my need. It's picking up a feather and noticing that it's not gray, but it's 900 shades of gray, and praising God for the glory of His created artistry. It's just a Godwardness, a God awareness. It's baking bread and thinking that the interaction between the yeast and the gluten of flour is one of millions of chemical reactions that came out of the mind of God, and I worship as the bread's rising. It's just this God awareness that I live with.
Mm. Yeah. Amen. Well, that's something that we love here at this ministry, and we want to spread a passion for that type of God-centeredness to anyone that has eyes to see and ears to hear. Paul, this has been really wonderful tonight. Thank you so much for being with us as part of this broadcast. Thanks to you all for tuning in tonight to the broadcast or for joining in and being a part of it. Thanks for all of you that have participated. If you want to continue to submit tweets or retweets about this broadcast, we encourage you to please use the hashtag #AskPT. But we're grateful to the Lord tonight for this opportunity to be with you, and I trust to minister to you. We're thankful for our partner in ministry tonight, Crossway Books, and Paul for being with us. If you want to find out more about Paul's ministry, you can go to www.paultrippministries.org, and you can learn about what God has called Paul to do in his writing and in his teaching and preaching ministry. So thanks again for being with us tonight, and we pray that God would bless you. Good night.
Amen.